coming up on LCTV News.
We have the latest profiles on two GOP nominees who visited Dubuque.
And we take an inside look into two crucial votes that could help a small town rebuild after a disaster.
What it's done is it's brought the community together.
And hear how a major power plant is going green for the future.
All this and more coming up next.
You're watching LCTV News, delivering you Dubuque.
Good evening. Iowa Republic presidential candidate Herman Cain made a brief visit to Dubuque yesterday morning.
This is the first time that Cain has appeared in Iowa since allegations of sexual harassment emerged against him, but lately all anyone is talking about is Libya. Monday afternoon during an interview in Milwaukee, Cain fumbled his response when asked a question about President Obama's actions in Libya. With all that's being said about Cain, he still believes his approach as a businessman will get things done in office.
Politicians will propose things that they believe they can pass. Businessmen propose ideas to fix the problem.
Although Cain's visit to Dubuque was brief, he was able to address issues with the people of Dubuque.
Senator Rick Santorum made a visit to the Star Brewery in Dubuque yesterday as a part of this year's Iowa caucus. Santorum made a speech to his supporters after meeting them one by one. His speech consisted of promises of what he would do if elected president.
I've got a track record. You know, unlike the other folks in the race, I've got a solid track record of having done that in the toughest place to promote those values, and that's Washington, D.C. I've got a track record of standing up for those values and succeeding. And I've got a great plan to make sure that that happens going forward.
Santorum spoke about how to improve the economy and his plans on steering away from Obama's health care plan. He also acknowledged Iran as a current threat. Santorum finishes his visit with questions from the audience.
Residents of Kaufman Avenue and Valeria Street have begun petitioning to the city asking for help. Their backyards fill up with water, but the water doesn't leave. According to resident Dennis Kramer, there was about 560,000 gallons of water in their backyards, and it took people about 36 hours to get the water pumped out. But that did not solve the problem.
If it comes down to the city needing to put a pump in here, my yards, I'm willing to have it put in, you know, and I'm sure the neighbors would too, you know, just to get the water out of here.
The city of Dubuque is willing to look into the problem since it involves a community of neighbors. Although no solution has been found at this point, the city is still unsure if it will solve the problem completely.
Maybe we can't solve the problem, but maybe we can lessen it or make it manageable, more manageable.
The city of Dubuque engineers plan to meet with the residents to get a better understanding of the problem in order to fix it properly. Monday morning, a fire erupted inside a large Dittmer recycling truck at Brunskill Road and Dodge Street. It has been confirmed that the cause of the fire was cardboard leaning up onto a light bulb. Police estimate around $5,000 in the damage to the recycling truck, but a tow truck was not required.
As of October, the last bit of coal in Alliant Energy's coal site was officially used up due to a recent conversion to natural gas. The reason behind the switch was to keep the current times and progressive standards.
Coal is being looked at less and less by the government as a way that you're going to produce power in the future. And so as a company, we have to start looking today at how we make that transition and how we make it in a way that's most cost effective for customers.
Since the coal is out and the natural gas is in, this means that some Alliant workers are now out of jobs.
As you retire old plants, that is obviously one of the toughest pieces of this, is there are people that have spent their career working here. This is their plant. They've worked on it, cared for it, and taken care of it, and that's always a tough part.
Drozinski says the biggest benefit of switching to natural gas is the emissions will be cleaner. Alliant Energy isn't the only thing that's going green in the tri-states. Thanks to a grant from the Illinois Clean Energy Community Foundation, Galena will be going green too. The city of Galena has been awarded a grant to help fund their wastewater facility. The $908,820 grant will be used for installing a 330-kilowatt solar photovoltaic system at their wastewater facility. This will help make the small town more sustainable for their residents.
We want to be viewed as a leader in the sustainability movement.
With becoming more sustainable, Galena is also able to reduce the cost that they're spending on electricity in order to run the wastewater plant.
The PV solar system is expected to offset about 50% of the energy that we now use for the sewer treatment plant.
Transforming of the water plant is hoped to be started in April and finished by August of this year.
With natural disasters, it takes time to rebuild. The residents of the small town of Lake Delhi experienced a disaster and are ready to move forward. Reporter Ellen Reese has more.
Two summers ago, more than 200 residents of Lake Delhi found their houses flooded. Now they recently voted on two significant measures that will affect the future of the small town and their road to recovery. Looking forward is something residents of Lake Delhi have always done. In July of 2010, Lake Delhi faced devastation as a dam broke and flooded out several houses in the area. But now, thanks to two recent votes, Lake Delhi is one step closer to recovery.
There's many jobs probably already lost. Businesses have already started to go out of business. We need to stop that and start going back into getting this economic engine rebuilt.
In early November, residents of Lake Delhi voted to transfer the ownership of the lake from the privately owned Lake Delhi Recreation Association over to the community.
After these two elections, I heard nothing but just, we're on our way.
More than 95% of residents voted yes for both of these measures.
I think 90-some percent of the people on the lake really felt, if we want a lake, we have to do this.
Along with the transfer of ownership, residents also voted to pay an extra $6 million in taxes over the next 20 years in order to help even more with the reconstruction. This switch will make it easier for Lake Delhi to receive federal funds in order to rebuild even as early as next spring. For now, though, the community will just keep looking forward.
There's so much sentiment that we want the lake back, that people around this area want the lake back, the community needs this lake back.
Now the next step for the new Board of Trustees is to approve engineering plans for the new dam.
So Ellen, are there going to be any adjustments made to a new dam?
Yes, in fact, when I spoke with them, they were talking about how they will be installing a new spillway, which will hold additional capacity for some more water.
Okay, thanks Ellen. Maquoketa High School and Ford dealership teamed up this past weekend. Drive One for Your School and Burnett Teal Ford came to Maquoketa High School this past Saturday.
Our goal is to get 300 people to do the test drive today. And if we get the 300 people to do the test drive, we will earn $6,000 for our school.
Maquoketa High School met its goal. The money will go towards the athletic programs at Maquoketa.
It really does help our school because with the limited funding and the financial situation that schools are in.
This hasn't been the first time that Drive for Your School has come to the high school. 2 years ago, Burnett Teal Ford held the same event. This fundraiser is one of the larger athletic boosters for Maquoketa.
The Mines of Spain is increasing its size by 52 acres. The acreage is located adjacent to E.B. Lyons Interpretive Center. This addition has been in the works for several years.
Once this new property is paid off, it'll become city property. We'll attach it to our lease and manage it right along with everything else.
Buckles says the members of the community that have heard about the addition are happy.
This could have very easily have gone to a housing development, and we would have had, housing, right in the backyard here.
Once the old buildings are removed off the property, the last bit of funds come in, new plants and prairie grasses will be planted.
Potosi, Wisconsin was one of 24 communities to be showcased at the National League of Cities Convention last week in Phoenix, Arizona. The project of taking a building that was constructed before Abraham Lincoln was elected president and renovating it to make it look like the brewery it is today was recognized by
many.
When
we explained the Potosi project to them and what we did and how we did it, their reaction was, wow.
The convention was intended to showcase communities and projects like the Potosi Brewery that other communities could build off of.
All you have to do is look at people's reaction and you realize the significance of what has been done.
In 3 years' time, the brewery has brought in around 150,000 visitors and tourists.
After the break,
hear why doctors recommend an HPV vaccination for children as young as 9.
And find out how student loans may be paying easier.
I find inspiration all around me, from those that push me to think and to grow, to move forward, because to stand still is to fall behind. That's not my plan. I'm just getting started. My life is just beginning. My major is inspiration.
I'm on mydohawk.com.
I'm on mydohawk.
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 I'm on my Dewhawk.
I'm on my Dewhawk.
I'm on MyDoHawk.com. Are you?
MyDoHawk.com. Delivering you Dubuque.
The discussion of year-round school is nothing new for many schools, but now is being highly considered. Lengthening the school day or the school year will be on the official agenda when the Iowa legislature meets in January. Parents and teachers have shown support for either lengthening the school day or extending past the 180-day school year through several town hall meetings with Iowa politicians. This change could cost the district thousands of dollars, but educators believe this additional time will fulfill more students' educational needs. For now, schools will have to wait and see what legislators decide.
Schools may be changing the length of their school days, but President Obama is changing the length of paying off student loans. President Obama announced a new plan for paying back federal student loans, but this new arrangement only affects federal loans, not loans through private lenders.
This is specifically towards our federal student loans. There are students who also have to borrow through the private loan program. These terms that the Obama plan are addressing or offering up don't apply to those loans.
Some of the effects will not be implemented until January 2012, but include multiple advantages. These benefits include a lower interest rate and an income-based payment plan, which means students will be able to pay what they can towards their loans. The rate is currently at 15%, and it is proposed that it will be lowered to 10%. This particular piece will not be exceeded until 2014. This week in our Health Beat, we take a close look at one of the sexually transmitted diseases in the United States, HPV. Currently, there are 20 million Americans infected with this HPV virus, but with a new recommendation from doctors, the chances of getting this virus could be significantly lowered.
My son is 11, and I'm seriously thinking of also having him to receive it.
The recommendation states that boys and girls as young as 9 years of age should be vaccinated for the human papillomavirus.
The young children, 11 to 13-year-olds who get the vaccine, have a better take or a better immune response to the vaccine than late teenagers or young adults do.
This is to ensure chances of receiving genital herpes, as well as many cancers formed by HPV, are significantly lower for both the receiver of the vaccination and their sexual partners. Some of the cancers that may be formed by HPV are cervical cancer, oral cancers, penile cancer, and anal cancer.
It's estimated that about 6 million Americans will contract an HPV infection every year.
Although cancers make up only 10% of these infections, if you do that math, this leaves 600,000 people infected with potential cancer-causing viruses.
The vaccine is a three-shot series. It's spread out over 6 months. So you get the initial shot, your second shot at a minimum of 2 months later, and the third shot a minimum of 4 months after the second shot.
If all three shots are completed for the HPV vaccination, the chances of getting cancers such as cervical cancer, oral cancer, or penile cancer in men are decreased by 100%.
You know, Lauren, I've heard some parents' comments about the vaccination, and, you know, they're thinking that this could be promoting kids to have sex at a younger age.
Yeah, you know, I actually addressed that in my interview with the doctor, and he said that he himself has given his kids a vaccination, and he reiterated to me the importance of their young immune system will adapt to the medicine better.
Okay. Well, we actually did a poll on our website, mydohawk.com, and 48% voted yes, that parents thought this was a good idea. And 43% said no, and then the other 10% were undecided. Last Saturday, the Five Flag Center hosted a Native American culture event. The event was free and open to the public and ended up having a great turnout. The night included storytelling, education on Native American traditions, and various forms of dancing and song. Brian Hamill, a two-time hoop dancing world champion, put on a particularly spectacular performance for the audience.
When I have a good crowd that you can really feel the positive energy, it's a feeling that can't be beat by anything. It's just amazing.
Hamill loves to perform, but he hopes that audiences will take away a greater message from his performance.
Well, it's cultural diversity, your unity through diversity. The more you share, the more you open up, the more people see that there's different things and they can embrace different cultures.
And with applause throughout the night, it was clear people of Dubuque appreciated the effort.
Wow, I absolutely love their outfits. Well, coming up after the break,
see how Lawrence men's and women's
basketball played their season openers.
And find out who was crowned the new Miss Northeast Iowa after the break.
We'll be right back.
What is a knight?
A knight speaks out for justice,
is giving to others,
participates in his church,
supports his brothers,
loves his country.
And a knight is centered in Christ.
What is a knight?
I am.
I am.
I am.
I am.
I am.
I am a Knight of Columbus.
Join us.
The Dolores men's soccer team defeated the University of Minnesota Morris to advance the second round of the NCAA soccer tournament. Dolores played Calvin College with home field advantage at the Rock Bowl. Early in the game, the Knights get the advantage when Lawrence Murray kicks the ball deep to Sean Brokowins, who heads it in to make the score 1-0. Later in the first half, Calvin does it again as Travis Vedker scores against Dolores as goalkeeper Nate Dubois couldn't get a hold of this one. Advantage Calvin 2-0, and DuHawk Nation is in shock. Calvin would add another goal in the beginning of the second half and would put this one in here as the Knights break away and Dubois isn't even by the net to put Calvin up 4-0. After the game, the DuHawks thank their fans for one last time this season, and they give the love right back. The final here, Calvin 4, Dolores nothing. Now onto the women's as they played the Rock Bowl for the second round as well. Dolores and St. Benedict gathered on Sunday to continue their respective quests towards national soccer dominance. Dolores would strike first blood with a perfectly placed header from senior Kate Young to put the DuHawks on top 1-0, and the Dolores fans here feel good about that one. But unfortunately, Dolores' momentum would be cut short by the Blazers' goal quickly thereafter. We're tied up here 1-1. Even some Blazers fans come out to Dolores to try to get things going. The game was a physical one with both teams trying to stay alive in the NCAA bracket. Even after a second St. Benedict's goal, the Dolores fans stood firm behind their team. Dolores was hoping Katie Chambers would do her magic at corner kicks, but fell short of getting a goal. St. Benedict came out victorious with a final score of 2-1, eliminating Dolores from playoffs. The women's basketball team played their first game at the home against University of Wisconsin-La Crosse. The Eagles got a hold of the game quickly as Rachel Salata passes this off to Casey Robinson, who spins it in to put this one in the bucket. UW-La Crosse will continue to dominate the first half as Jenna Anderson drains the three-pointer, put her team up even farther. Coach Heinzen calls a timeout to get his team back on track. In the second half, Dolores would start to come back as Melissa Herman would put up this two. Later in the game, with the score tied at 45 apiece, Langemeyer comes up to the line to put this one. The DuHawks would not look back from there. The fan section cheers as the team celebrate their first win of the season, 63-52. Now onto the men's basketball team. They played the 25th-ranked Wheaton Thunder. Dolores came out with the game with a huge alley-oop to Jordan Harrelson, but Wheaton answered back quickly, taking back the tempo of the game. The Thunder controlled the first half convincingly, leaving the scoreboard at 44-28, heading into the locker room. Coming into the second half of the Thunder, forced 6 Dolores turnovers, costing the DuHawks valuable chances to get back into the game. Wheaton kept control of the second half, never letting Dolores get a strong rhythm, with Dolores never getting within 15 points of the Thunder. The Dolores men look forward to moving past this one as they lose big, 87-62. For Sports Shorts, I'm Mike Gelsnan. Back to you, Katie.
Thanks, Mike. This weekend, Dubuque crowned itself a new Miss Northeast Iowa. The competitors were judged based on a private interview, on-stage questioning, dress, and talent. So the competition wasn't just about beauty.
It's scholastic, it's service to others, it's style, and success.
Anna Jordzinski was crowned the new Miss Northeast Iowa and will participate in the Miss Iowa pageant during the first week in June. If Jordzinski takes that title, she will be eligible to compete for Miss America. Not only Miss Northeast Iowa was crowned, but Miss Outstanding Teen Nikki Neal, Junior Miss Northeast Iowa Brittany Costello, and Little Miss Northeast Iowa Stella DeLong. You'll be seeing these new title holders out and about in the community.
Next, we'll be doing appearances. They'll be continuing to work on their platforms and their community service. That's a huge part of the Miss America program.
Wow, that looks like a lot of fun. Well, that's all the time that we have for you this week.
Check out our additional content on MyDuHawk.com and follow us on our Twitter at MyDuHawk.